va passer rapidement à notre prochain intervenant. Alors justement, on parlait d'open source, on va rentrer dans une thématique plus précise, en tout cas qui s'applique plus précisément à l'open source. Est-ce que le droit, donc c'est notre prochaine thématique, a relevé le défi de l'open source? Et pour parler de cette question avec nous, je vous demande d'accueillir les professeurs, directrice au CRID, pardon, Centre de Recherche, Information, Droit et Société, Madame Séverine Dussolier.
Merci beaucoup. Je ne suis plus directrice du CRITS, mais je suis toujours membre du CRITS et professeure à Sciences Po ici à Paris. On m'a demandé d'intervenir en anglais, donc si c'est toujours OK, je continue en anglais ou je passe au français. Okay. So the question I've been asked to address is, has the law passed the challenge of open source? And of course, I could start by answering that question by a common trick, by challenging the very notion of the two terms that are included in that question. What is open source and what is the law? What is open source? First, in my question, do I refer to open source as a legal organization defined by its licensing web and legal mechanisms, or do I define it as a social organization? And the event of today and tomorrow is certainly a strong evidence of open as being a social organization. And what about law? We could also discuss about what is law. Is it the law as it is written in legislatively adopted acts and codes, or is it more broadly what regulates the behavior of people? If we opt for the second definition, I think that open source itself could be deemed to be law, as it can be for some individuals akin to a genuine norm regulating their behavior. But I could also reverse the question, and I could ask whether the law passed the challenge of open source. I could also ask, has the open source passed the challenge of the law? And I will actually ask the two questions. The only word that I have not questioned yet is challenge. Is there really a challenge between open source and law, or do we just exaggerate the conflict between law and open source? So let me start at the beginning and ask all those questions together. So the invitation that I've received to speak today, and I really thank the organizers for that invitation, was to make me talk about the meeting of law and open source and open environments. And I suppose it was based on the implicit assumption that they are antagonists, that open source is at worst against the law, and I understand it has copyright or intellectual property law, or at best outside of the law. And I think that is not true, that the open source both has a movement and has a normative system, has created its own space within the intellectual property law itself. But it's true that in some respects, it is in a position of opposition in that space. First, I would say that open source has taken its distance with law and has positioned itself against the copyright law. This is evident from its very nickname. When we talk about copyleft, it is, of course, to play on that opposition between left and right. The leftist of intellectual property would be the copyleft proponents, and they would be against the conservatives of copyright. And to some extent, it's true that open source has been used as a counter-weapon in the intellectual property wars. And in a context where copyright has become so excessive, so extensive, so close and exclusionary, it's true that copyleft has been presented as an alternative to copyright, and sometimes as what could be loved as the opposite of copyright. Left in copyleft also indicates that the right is not taken. Its creator prefers to leave it to the public, to abandon it. And actually, this is not how it goes, of course. This is very well known now that copyleft is not an abandonment of copyright, a relinquishment of copyright. Open source is not giving something to the public domain with no right at all. On the contrary, instead of giving up copyright in a work, be it a software, a text, a film, a scientific article, copyleft leverages the copyright, the exclusive right conferred by copyright, to grant freedoms to use the work. And this is the magic of copyleft, of open source. This is the invention itself that of copyleft. So In a way, copyleft is a reversion of copyright, or we could also say a subversion of copyright, because it used copyright not to exclude anyone from the use of the work, but to include all the public, all the contributors, the developers, the users, the communities in the use and development of that work. So in that sense, what could say that open source is against copyright because it makes it operate in a completely different way. But its magic is to be against copyright by using copyright itself. And actually, it's for me, it's what copyright should do, because copyright should not be considered solely as something to exclude. Copyright is only a right of property, we could discuss that, that enable the creator to authorize or prohibit the use of a work. And it could perfectly be used to authorize broadly. And this is exactly what copyleft does. So for me, copyleft is an exercise of copyright, it's not public domain, and it also rehabilitates something that is essential in copyright. It is the authorization that copyright can give. So I have said so far that copyright, intellectual property law, and open source is not in opposition. But finally, what is the outcome of their meeting in the legal stage? So first, as the open source passed the challenge of the law. So far, nothing indicates the contrary. The copyleft regime is based on contract and licenses, and their legality has never been put to test so far. We have some case law about open source, Creative Commons licenses, but they have never really challenged the validity of those licenses, and they have enforced those licenses. So there is no real issue in law with open source. We have some minor discussion about some reflection about the extent of the virality, what is the notion of the derivative work upon which the contamination of copyleft can operate, what is the extent of the use of copyleft licensing in employment contracts, a lot of small questions that makes us lawyers think and discuss, and it's good for us, but it's not really problematic for open source. I would say rather that the possibility to use the copyright law to distribute works in open source scheme rather demonstrate the plasticity of the law, its flexibility in that field. So I reverse the question. Has the law passed the test of open source? This is a very different question and a more interesting one, I think. Being a contract, open source licenses could be considered as not challenging the law because they are just private ordering tools applicable to the contractual parties only. That would be, though, a very limited view, because what is so interesting about open source, it is that it has troubled the law, both as a legal and as a normative system, and has an ideology and a social norm. As a legal system, the trick of copyleft, the fact that we assert copyright to actually grant inclusivity instead of exclusion, this is something that is so powerful in modifying our conceptions and exercise of intellectual property. And intellectual property has been changing so much in the last 20 years, and part of that change, I think, is due to the open innovation movements. Law can pretend that it is just a contractual tool, that it happens in a contractual sphere, that it has no effect on the law itself. But the viral effect of most copyleft licenses has the consequences that the sharing obligation runs with the object it regulates, be it a software or other type of work. And so it's not only a mere contract limited to the parties, but the open source norm becomes almost a right against the world as it binds any users or developer or sharers of the software or of another work. Secondly, lawmakers have also started to take into consideration the possible consequences of law on open innovation. Remember the aborted draft directive on software patents, where open source defense has been at the forefront. Other traces of the installation of open source development in the exercise of copyright are starting to show in legal debates, slowly but surely, I think. As in open access for scientific obligation, this scientific norm and desire to share scientific publication and not apply very strong copyright rules on scientific publication and started to make lawmakers adopt strong promotion of open access licenses in science. And I think that more fundamentally, the ideology of copyleft and open innovation creation has left a very strong trace in law. The ethos of sharing and inclusion has radically challenged our conception of copyright. It has introduced a strong limitation within the exclusion force of copyright. Some say that copyleft is a consented public domain in the very core of copyright, and I think there is a strong symbolic here that challenge the almost the very strong symbolic of prohibition in intellectual property. It has also challenged traditional incentive-based rationale of intellectual property, and intellectual property is generally seen as thought also as being necessary to incentivize creation and innovation in public goods. But being able to exclude others from the use of such creation is not the only tool to achieve innovation. You know that, of course, already. But IP lawyers sometimes are slow to understand that too. And I think that open source clearly shows that non-exclusion can be a powerful motive to create and disseminate one's creation and to develop that creation. It shows that another economy of creation is possible and is thriving, actually, for the last 10 years. And it also raised very interesting question about the remuneration as a necessary link to copyright and to intellectual property. Last but not least to me is the fact that the very notion of authorship that sustains copyright as a right of a unique source and author, where an individual that is called the author as some sort of sacred person, and that person then gets the power to exclude anyone else, to decide about the fate of his or her work, has been completely shattered by open source and copyleft. It was already made fragile by contestation of authorship in aesthetic, in philosophy, by Barthes, by Foucault, and also by artists themselves. But now it really come closer to the law. Because copyleft distributes authorship between multiple authors and include also readers and users in the production and dissemination of the work. And this is, in my view, the most radical challenge that open source brings to copyright law. But this is still a test that copyright law has to pass, because copyright lawmakers still think as the authors being the only character that has value in copyright law. So to conclude, I would say that open source is really full of promises for a change in copyright practices, and also for a change in copyright law. In a way, it brings some ecology in the practice of intellectual property, and intellectual property is really missing in that regard. And it restores the autonomy of the author, and also the autonomy of the public, the autonomy of all the persons that actually share the creation with the author or the multiple authors. And this is what copyright should be about. It is not anymore, in a way, it has deviated, I think, from its original reason. And I think that if only open source could inspire a better and more balanced copyright, then I think the copyright law would have passed the test of open source with honors. But it's still not there yet. Thank you.
Merci, merci Madame Dussolier.